Hello, and welcome to the Bias Blood Ministry Saturday, or I'm sorry, rather Sunday morning worship service. I am your host, Minister G.L. Harden, and I thank you all for tuning into our Ustream broadcast. Our message today is coming out of Proverbs chapter 16, verse 9, and we have titled this subject, Order My Steps in Your Word. Order My Steps in Your Word. And this message has been inspired by the late Dr. Miles Monroe, and actually one of my former high school football coaches some 30 years ago by the name of Butch Ingram. And then rather, thirdly, it's been inspired by a wonderful dear friend of mine, also named Michaela Roberts. When we're talking about leadership, not only in the ministry, but leadership in everything that we do. You see, being a true leader isn't always a popular thing to do. And in most cases, it draws people against you or away from you, just like it did in the days of Noah, when he was trying to build the ark. And people thought he was crazy, building an ark when it hadn't rained in over 100 plus days. In the days of Isaiah, the prophet, who folks thought he was a wonderful prophet, but at the same time, he was running from Jezebel. And even Jesus himself was one of the great leaders of our times. So you might say that leadership is something no one truly wants to be a part of, because it's about giving up yourself in order to lift up someone else with absolutely no reward. And in many cases, not even a thank you for your sacrifice. So Proverbs chapter 16 verse 9 reads like this. It's real simple. It says, the heart of a man plans his way, but the Lord establishes his step. I'll read that one more time. In Proverbs chapter 16 verse 9, it says, the heart of a man plans his way, but the Lord establishes his steps. Another word for establish is order. The Lord orders his steps. Let us pray. Father, we come to you on a bended knee, for you are worthy to be praised. And Lord, I just want to say thank you for giving me another chance to confess my sins and all my iniquities to you, O Lord, and ask for your complete forgiveness from falling short of your glory. Lord, I am weak and I am at a total loss for words in hopes of my redemption being made whole once again, and that it is finished. I pray for all of our brothers and sisters who are in this fight to defeat the enemy who comes to try to steal, kill, and destroy. Yet in you, O Lord, we already have the victory, and we will rejoice and be glad. I am your son, and you, my Father. In this bond, I am set free. I am made new. I am sanctified. I am a God which I was created after. I say these words in the honor of your begotten Son, and it is so. It is so. So when we think of leaders, or great leaders, there are so many that comes to mind. Gandhi, who taught the method of nonviolence, and some might even say Vince Lombardi, who was one of the pioneers of the NFL, who led by example, and many. He also led by example in many business organizations that are non-athletic. Many of them, they use Lombardi's quotes for motivating their team or staff. And then we have the late but great Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who, with many other leaders among him, was the true leader in leading a nation to learn to love one another despite their race, creed, or color. And with great leadership comes great responsibility. Many of most leaders, if you really look closely at their program, they always had a great woman behind their leadership. And this is a fact, my beloveds, that most leaders, all the way up to presidents, have a great leader, a great woman, who is their biggest adversary when it comes to making the best decisions for the sake of not only people whom they're leading, but first and foremost, God. So we ought to thank every woman today on their leadership that in many cases does not get proper reward or gratitude or appreciation that they so rightly deserve. So today on the By His Blood Ministries, we'd like to say thank you to all those silent partners who tarried alongside their great men as well. And one of the things I've learned in these past decades is that the role of a leadership has changed. Everywhere you seem to look no longer to the leaders of today are made of stuff of the leaders of yesterday. Now, I'm not saying to say that to throw shade on them, as they say. But these new jacks of new jacks of this generation have changed tremendously. And what I'm saying is that the role of a leader has been modified and downgraded to nothing more than micromanaging and very little leadership involvement. Even when you look at corporate America, it has downsized to little to nothing. For decades and decades, men and women of this great nation were able to maintain their households by working 50-hour weeks and still help the kids with homework and school projects. Even the American dollar was solid and sound and worth something. Yet something changed. It changed in our hearts and our minds and in our souls. And where these mothers and fathers who were the leaders in every household became collateral damage, leading into the 20th and 21st century. I find it truly amazing that God is the same God today, tomorrow, and forever. Yet man's word has absolutely no truth to it, no validity, no honor, no integrity, and certainly no leadership. And we are talking about leadership, right? I want to play this video. I had a video I wanted to play for you that Dr. Miles Monroe talked about. And in that video, I'm gonna see, can I pull it up real quick? In that video, a really short video, but he was talking about the leadership of today and how leadership, how just like I just noted that it has changed tremendously. Tremendously. So I'm going to play this clip for you real quick by Dr. Miles Monroe discussing leadership.
The greatest act of leadership, el acto más grande del liderazgo, is what happens in your absence. ¿Qué pasa en tu ausencia? If everything you've done died with you, si todo lo que tú has hecho muere contigo, you are a failure. Eres un fracasado. True leadership, verdadero liderazgo, is measured by what happens after you die. Se mide también con qué pasa después que tú mueres. This is why true leaders, es por eso que verdaderos líderes, don't invest in buildings. No invierten en edificios. Jesus never built a building. Jesús nunca construyó un edificio. They invest in people. Ellos invierten en personas, en gente. Why? ¿Por qué? Because success, porque éxito, without a successor, sin uno que le suceda después, is failure, es fracaso. So your legacy, así que tu legacy should not be in buildings, no debe ser programas, en programas, projects, y proyectos. Your legacy, tu legacy must be people, debe ser en personas. So the greatest act of a leader, así que el acto más grande del líder, is mentoring, es ser un mentor, mentorear. Who are you mentoring? ¿A quién estás mentoreando? To take your place. Para que tome tu lugar luego. True leaders, verdadero líder, make themselves unnecessary. Llegan a ser no necesarios.
I'm going to repeat it again.
Repito otra vez.
True leaders,
verdaderos líderes,
make themselves
se hacen a ellos
unnecessary.
Que son innecesarios.
A true leader,
un verdadero líder,
work themselves out of a job.
Trabajan de tal manera que se quedan sin trabajo.
So great leaders,
grandes líderes,
measure their greatness,
se miden su grandeza,
by their absence.
En su ausencia, cuando están ausentes.
Study Jesus.
Estudia a Jesús.
Greatest leader of all.
El líder más grande de todos los tiempos.
Listen to his words.
Escuche sus palabras.
It is better for you.
Es mejor para vosotros.
That I go away.
Que yo me vaya.
If I do not go away.
Si no me voy.
You won't be great.
No serán grandes ustedes.
My absence.
Mi ausencia.
Is your greatness.
Es tu grandeza. Wow.
He proved his greatness.
Él probó su grandeza.
By leaving.
Por irse.
He left.
Ese fue.
And his organization grew in his absence.
Y su organización creció en su ausencia.
My question is,
mi pregunta
if
es,
you die today,
si tú te mueres
as a leader,
como líder,
leaving the studio,
dejando
in an accident,
en un accidente,
what happens to your organization?
¿Qué pasa con
what happens to your church?
¿Qué pasa
what happens to your business?
¿Qué pasa con tu negocio?
If it dies,
si muere,
when you die,
cuando tú mueres,
you're a failure.
Eres un fracasado.
So I encourage you right now.
Te animo ahora mismo.
Identify your successors.
Identifica aquellos que te van a seguir
and
a ti
mentor
después.
Them.
Y entrénalos.
And train them.
Entrénalos.
This is why
es por eso que
in our organization,
en nuestra organización,
I am unnecessary.
Yo no soy necesario allí.
I can travel the world.
Yo puedo viajar por todo el mundo.
And our ministry grows.
Y nuestro ministerio
the
crece.
Grow.
La compañía crece.
My son,
mi hijo,
who is 29 years old,
que tiene 29 años de edad,
is running my businesses.
Él corre mis negocios.
My daughter,
mi hija,
who is 30,
que tiene 30,
is running our global organization.
Ella maneja toda nuestra organización.
Why? I mentored them.
Yo las entrené.
Jesus Christ.
Jesús
said to Peter.
Le dijo a Pedro.
Do you love me?
Me amas?
He said yes, Lord.
Sí, señor.
He said then the company is yours.
Entonces la compañía es tuya.
Feed the people.
Alimenta a la gente.
And he left.
Y se fue.
What happens?
¿Qué pasa?
In your absence.
En tu ausencia.
That's your legacy.
Eso es tu legado.
Wow.
Wow.
That was again. That was the late Dr. Miles Monroe, talking about true leadership. What happens when you die? Does your legacy or your leadership role, does it die along with you? And if it does, you haven't been much of a leader, because a great leader leads, and he leaves a continuance of greatness to be fulfilled, as Jesus Christ did for us and through us. We are continuing his leadership role by following his steps. So in this text, it has a very basic and direct instructions to man concerning leadership, but not just any old kind of leadership, yet leadership toward the Father. Look again at what it says in Proverbs 16, verse 9, and I'm going to read it from the NIV version. It says, in their hearts, human plan their course, but the Lord establishes the steps. And one thing for sure, that man has complete control of his heart, and from the words that he speaks, it all starts from the heart. In the past several months, we've been witnessing the carnage of young black men being murdered in the streets, in department stores. And even yesterday, on a clear Sunday afternoon, a 12-year-old boy was gunned down and shot, again at a park, I believe, in Cleveland, I believe. And all of these killings were ordered years ago by government officials. Now, I know that's a harsh thing to say, yet nowhere in history have you heard and seen such senseless killings taking place every hour on the hour. And we're supposed to think it's just something new. And we also know that every 28 hours, a young black male or female is killed by a police officer, amounting to nearly 500 black youths deaths per year by a police officer. And I thank God that our brown brothers and sisters aren't being gunned down as much as African Americans, but no killing is okay in the eyes of God. And even today, another cabinet member in the Obama administration, I think it was this past Monday, he resigned. Secretary of Defense Chuck Hagel, he was actually asked to resign his post because of his stance on the looming global crises dealing with the Middle East, to name a few. And there's an old saying, you're only good as your leadership. And what you must understand, that the president of these United States does not run this country. I'm so sad to say. It's the wealthy and those global elites who simply believe that they are gods. But how are they gods? Through power? Through magic? Through the Holy Spirit? No. None of these are correct. The correct answer. Because they are gods through their money and their collective agreement to conquer and colonize other countries, stealing their wealth and using it to run God's world. It's not rocket science, my people. It's systematic and demonic. And there is no good, no God in their hierarchy. It's just them. And this is the type of leadership of this scripture is talking about. Men having the means to lead from their hearts, yet knowing that the real leadership must come from God and by God alone, by ordering their steps. And not just in the political ring, but in everything that they do. And God shouldn't be the head. God should be the head and Christ the center of all things. Yet that's not how they roll, the wealthy and the wicked. So let's look at the flip side of man when he decides to say, hey, forget God. I can do whatever I want to do. And no one's going to stop me. Look at what it says in Matthew chapter 15, verses 18 through 20, when it reads, but the things that proceed out of the mouth come from the heart, and those defile the man. Verse 19 says, for out of the heart comes evil thoughts, murder, adulterers, fornicators, thefts, false witnesses, slanders. Verse 20, these are the things which defile man. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile the man. All these things are how the world is being controlled by evil men and some women as well, running amok of God's world because God has given all men free will to live a life as he has been instructed. Yet, where on earth did these men come from? Men who don't care if God punishes them, and men who would rather be liars and murderers and adulterers, fornicators, who would do anything to destroy this earth and take down leading your family into corrupt times. So amazing. Are you asking your children to just ignore the signs of Satan and just go along to get along? And God will someday rescue us. Well, that's a bold-faced lie. God is waiting for the people of God to unite and stand together and say to this entire nation, enough is enough. And yet the clergy, the so-called leaders and local politicians are trying to get people to comply to the evils of this world. And it's a setup. And it's mockery in the eyes of God, because the same God who sent his only son to die for you, you have said to God, hey, they may take us out, they may take my house, my job, my 401k away if I stand with you. So what can you do for me, God? Have you no shame? Remember what Jesus said about the birds being fed and how not to worry about where your next meal is coming from, where you will find shelter and clothing. When you walk with God, all these things are already prepared for you. Nothing is too hard or too challenging for God. Yet why are you making it so hard on yourself by being entertained by social media, CNN News, YouTube, and smart TV? And most people have truly given up on God. And I'm even talking to so-called Christian folk. Folk want God, yet they don't want all of God. I always say that. And why? Because they have they have been duped by the system, to believe everything coming out of their high-priced cell phones dealing with this country is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And what a mighty shame that is. It's so awesome that even in the previous verse in Proverbs, chapter 16, verse 8, it says, better a little with righteousness than much gain with injustice. So astonishing how men who know the Bible, meaning the wealthy and the wicked, knows and understands the word better than a bishop, a priest, or any other man of God. And still they continue to say no to God's will. Over and over, they refuse to commit and submit. And the only true explanation is that they have been declared Satan's disciples. Satan is their God. And for that, they must continue mayhem and destruction wherever they go. And one thing's for sure, people, these so-called puppeteers know that their days are numbered, and they are hoping that they have tricked enough people around the world to buy into their total control and submissiveness to the evil ways and none of God. And again, to my Christian folks, have you no shame? I want to tell you a story about a man who changed my life forever. And so funny, I was talking about him just the other day, and it has been nearly 40 years since I've seen him. And he's gone to be with the Lord now, yet while he was here on this earth, this remarkable man who was a football and basketball coach taught me the meaning of life. You see, my father left my mom and my siblings when I was around 5 or 6 years of age. And over the years, I saw my father less and less. Yet I would read the papers on the weekend and always see this man in the paper with this basketball team winning championships and tournaments all the time for years. I never met him, yet my spirit said I would do so. So finally, I made up my mind I wanted to go to this high school and try out for this team. I was about 15 years of old then, and my eldest brother, who attended that school a few years earlier, was now in the military, but he was home from leave. I asked my brother that summer, could I meet this coach? And my brother said to me, well, you got to know how to play defense and shoot free throws for this team. And I said I could do both. And actually, I was a pretty good ball handler as well. So the following weekend, my brother set up a meeting with this coach whose name is Butch Ingram. And man, was I nervous. It was only me, my brother, and the coach in this gym, and he asked me to start doing layups. And I looked horrible. I missed 4 layups. So he asked me to shoot some jump shots. And thank goodness I made almost all of my jump shots. And I did some free throws, and I survived those as well. The next thing I knew, I was attending this high school called Piper High School down in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, in my sophomore year. And man, was I excited. I had made the varsity basketball team, yet the first day of basketball training, before I made the team, there was no balls. The first week, we ran on the track for a whole week, doing sprints and running 5 to 10 miles for 5 days. Many players on that team quit, yet I kept coming. And the following week, we worked out on weights. And again, no gym, no basketball. And some more players quit as well. But for me, it was no turning back. The remarkable thing about this coach was that before we hit the track field or gym, even the basketball court, we headed for the library. And Coach Ingram told us that education was first, and then basketball was second. And he said, if we couldn't count our wages, then why play a sport that you would never see your dollars? So he would talk to us one-on-one each week about family issues, and if there was something he could do for some people, he gave money for light bills and gas and even rent. Others, he bought clothes, shoes, or school supplies. All along, he never asked anything of us, but to be honest, do everything the right way the first time, and good things will follow. I so love this man, and I thank God that my best friend, Michaela, brought this message out of me dealing with leadership. And with so much talent in South Florida, Butch never cheated or never tried to recruit players to his high school as many schools tried to recruit me for those 3 magnificent years. Well, a couple of players were alleged to have been partaking in smoking marijuana in the bathroom leading up to a championship game. Hours before this championship game, they were told The coach was told that these two players were in the bathroom smoking marijuana. And right then, the coach, and these were two starters, by the way, a point guard and a center. He was a guard and a center. And right then, he suspended both of those players. And he told them they couldn't play. We lost that game by 3 points. Yet when the newspapers asked him, why did he suspend them in the biggest game of the season, because we were favored to win this game, Butch answered by simply saying that they broke the rules of the team and their families. Now, that's the kind of leadership I'm so glad that I was a part of to witness. And my friend Michaela always reminds me that the fact that whatever I do in life, I must do it in excellence according to God and allow God to order my steps. Over and over, she tells me this on a weekly basis. And I'm so thankful that this word got into my spirit to bring it to you today. Again, in their hearts, humans plan their course, but the Lord orders their steps. What an awesome word from God to remind us that no matter what type of leadership we're in, that in the end, God still orders our steps. Won't you give him praise today and give him glory and honor? For he is so rightfully deserved. And as you walk out of your destiny in this universe, no matter what field you may be in, understand that it is through the mouths that the heart speaks. And we must be first established in the Lord in order to hear a word from God, in order for God to direct our path. Glory to God. Glory to God. And it is so. I want to thank you all for tuning in for this broadcast, and I pray that you would share this with your loved ones, your friends, and your family. And I ask you to stay tuned to hear some of the latest announcements dealing with this ministry. And if you'd like to sow into this ministry, you may do so by the preceding messages following this broadcast. And as we always say, to go in peace, and may God continue to bless you and your family and to order your steps. Thank you. Thank you. And may God bless you, and may God continue to keep you. Thank you for watching the By His Blood Ministries. We'd love for you to share this wonderful new ministry with you, your family, your friends, and your loved ones. And share the word about how God is building the kingdom. Tell them that there is a new ministry via internet that they can be a part of and enjoy each and every Saturday evening around 7 p.m. and on Sunday mornings at 7:45 a.m. as well as 6 p.m. on Sunday evenings. And we assure all those who log on that their lives will be magnified in the Lord. We also are seeking donors and sponsors for our new ministry in order to obtain a building in Alpharetta, Georgia, as well as in unison with the building. We have started a new Nehemiah project reaching from North Georgia all the way to South Georgia, to be exact. And our mission is simple: to sponsor 35 to 40 kids in a year-round project, from after-school programs, summer school, planting Liberty Gardens throughout their communities. Refurbishing abandoned buildings and houses and yards is only the tip of the iceberg. And we need you, my beloveds, to please give a generous donation of any kind, whatever God lays on your heart, in order to get this wonderful project started and that we've declared we've already have. At the bottom of this video, there will be a link to go to our website via holyspiritsradio.org. And there you can go from the Gifts from the Heart page and live to give. And we certainly thank you all for your steadfast and sowing seeds into this new ministry with your tithes, your gifts, and or offerings. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. And finally, don't forget to check us out on our internet station on our blog talk radio show called the Holy Spirit's Radio Show. And you can follow us
when you arrive there, and we will send you an email of all our new broadcasting each time we broadcast in real time. That website is also at the bottom of the screen, and don't forget, we're doing a live taping of our Blog Talk radio show every Sunday evening around 6:30 and or 6:30 p.m. that is, and or 11 p.m. Wonderful show it shall be, and we certainly hope you will flip over to our Blog Talk radio station and tune in to listen on Blog Talk Radio and watch us live on live stream as well. My people, you don't want to miss this show. We thank you again, and we hope to see you there. This is Minister G.L. Harden saying, stay free, stay well, and stay blessed. Peace.